My name is Tom Houston Orr. I'm the director of the School of Drama at the University of Oklahoma. In this program, I play Giulio Strozzi, a poet in 17th century Venice, and a man who was witness to the culture wars of his time. Like those we experience today, the culture wars in Venice involved the arts, the arguments between conservatives and progressives, the relationship between church and state, and especially the role of higher education in society. My character, Giulio Strozzi, was passionate about ideas. He loved a good debate. He loved to entertain friends. He loved a good meal. He loved to laugh. And he loved music, especially opera. By choice, he lived in Venice. As a poet in Venice, he could experiment because the Senate protected the writers and publishers from censorship by the Inquisition. This artistic freedom allowed him to experiment with an exciting new art form, commercial opera, performed for the paying public, not an invited audience of aristocrats. But the freedoms in Venice had to be earned. And some of the cultural battles had to be won.
Oh, bello. Buongiorno. A major battle in our cultural wars took place here, in Parva, between the university and the Jesuit college, which had tried to establish itself as a rival university. The Jesuit college was just over there on the other side of this lovely botanical garden. Parva has become the premier university in Italy, probably all of Europe, because our government protects the university. Padova pays the highest faculty salaries and has the largest budget in Italy, even though our faculty is only half the size of that in Bologna. Because Padova limits the number of local professors, our faculty is international, unlike that in Bologna, which offers professorships to its own citizens. Our medical school is the best in all of Europe. We hired the very first professors of botany and of pharmacology and formed the first clinical facility. Oh, and we have the very first botanical garden.
Our university has built a new theater for the study of anatomy, and our government has taken extraordinary steps to accommodate us. They time executions to provide cadavers for our dissection schedule, and dissections have become a form of theater during carnival season, with paying spectators wearing a mask. Though most students are the sons of wealthy Venetians, Padova draws students internationally, including Protestants from Germany and Muslims from Turkey.
By 1590, the Jesuit college here in Padova had become a serious rival to this university. They had recruited 450 students, including 70 nobles. Many Venetian families supported the Jesuit expansion because they saw a spiritual poverty and moral decline here at the university. The Jesuit reforms were a direct action against the lazy habits of the university students, who were referred to as the Bovisti because they took lectures here at the Palazzo Bo. The Bovisti regularly sent servants to attend lectures and even to take exams. The Jesuits offered a free tuition, spiritual guidance, and strict teaching methods, whereas professors at the university delivered 60 or 70 lectures per year. Instructors at the Jesuit college gave 300, whereas professors at the university earned extra income by charging their students for private tutorials. Instructors at the Jesuit college provided individual drill sessions for free. But in 1591, things snapped when the Jesuit college began offering doctoral degrees and to ring bells announcing the start of class. A gang of university students surrounded the Jesuit college. They shot off guns, they smashed the windows, they painted anti-Jesuit graffiti, they even ran naked in front of the Jesuit fathers and young students.
A delegation of students went to the Venetian Senate to speak against the Jesuits, and the rectors of the university sent two professors to appeal directly to the Doge. In their meeting, Cesare Cremonini, a professor of philosophy who was a gifted orator, took the lead. He invoked the distinguished tradition of the university and the trouble caused by the rogue anti-university set up by the Jesuits without permission from the Venetian Senate.
He argued that this anti-university had divided the students into factions, some calling themselves the Jesuits, the other Bovisti, just like the Guelphs and the Ghibellines. The Senate responded by ordering the Jesuits to restrict their teaching to Jesuit novices only, not to compete with the public university. In the end, the Jesuits were actually banished from all Venetian territories between 1606 and 1657. So, the university won this battle in the culture wars. The Senate may have sympathized with the rowdy students for another reason. Although they would not want their sons to participate. Venetians love a good street fight. Each fall, the government sanctions fist fights on the bridges between working men from rival gangs.
Hundreds of fighters line up on opposite sides of a bridge, while thousands of spectators watch the brawl from balconies, gondolas, and barges. The bridge fights are like organized sport, with fans for the rival teams and betting on the outcome. They have even been staged to entertain foreign dignitaries, such as the French ambassador or the Cardinal of Lyon.
The Jesuits may have lost the cultural war with the university, but the church still had the Inquisition. They continued to investigate professors suspected of heresy, especially Galileo and Cremonini.
Galileo's biggest problem with the Inquisition was his belief in a Copernican view of the solar system, with planets in orbit around the sun and moons in orbit around the planets. He believed what he observed through his own telescope, and he disputed the Earth-centered view still held by traditional scholars of Aristotle and, more importantly, by the Roman Church. Galileo himself was a pious Catholic. In 1611, he even went himself to Rome to demonstrate his telescope to the influential philosophers and mathematicians at the Jesuit Collegio Romano. He wanted them to see, with their own eyes, the moons of Jupiter. But despite his cordial reception, most Jesuits remained unconvinced, and many delivered sermons against Galileo's sun-centered theory of the universe. In 1632, Galileo published his Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems, and that very year he was ordered to appear before the Holy Office in Rome. A papal trial found him vehemently suspected of heresy. He was placed under house arrest for life in Tuscany. Galileo and Cremonini were friends in Padova. They were fellow skeptics, though about different principles. In 1599, they co-founded the Accademia dei Ricoverti, the Academy of the Sheltered, presumably from the Inquisition. This group, made up of the faculty and the students, actively and freely discussed such topics as religion and morality. They even invited the Jesuits to join in their debate. Their goal was to cultivate a lively debate about an interesting topic. But despite their common skepticism, Cremonini refused to look to Galileo's telescope. When asked why, Cremonini replied, "I do not wish to approve of things of which I have no knowledge nor have seen. And moreover, looking through those glasses gives me a headache." But he also added, "Oh, how much better it would be for Signor Galileo if he would not go down this path and leave the liberty of Padova." Cremonini wanted to keep the disciplines separate. In this case, astronomy and philosophy. Galileo was the expert in astronomy, but Cremonini was the expert in Aristotelian philosophy. Cremonini's principal issue with the Jesuits was his strict conviction that theology and philosophy were also separate disciplines. The Holy Inquisition surely had files on Cremonini. If not for the protection of Venice, he likely would have suffered Galileo's same fate, perhaps even worse. His ideas were certainly more threatening to the church. Cremonini was skeptical about the immortality of the human soul. He wondered if a death of the body also meant death of the soul. This possibility led him to speculate on the wisest course of life. He wondered if human pleasure might not be the best course. Many of his students, the future leaders of Venice, they really liked how this man thought. He could attract more than 400 students to his lectures, and he was the highest paid philosopher in all of Italy. He even served on William Harvey's doctoral examination committee. Cremonini's greatest accomplishment, however, and his greatest score in the culture war, was to inspire his former students to retain their intellectual curiosity, their skepticism, and their libertine attitudes even after they graduated and returned to Venice, where they became the most influential citizens. Although Galileo was a scientist, his father Vincenzo was a musician. He worked with a group of noblemen and experimental artists in Florence known as the Florentine Camerata. They invented a new art form, which we call opera. Vincenzo Galilei had been a student of the great music theorist Zarlino in Venice, and he became well known as author of a treatise entitled Dialogue of Ancient and Modern Music. In his treatise, Galilei recommended that modern composers should emulate the music of ancient Greek drama in their new works. Experiments by the Camerata in Florence led to the very first operas presented for private audiences at the Florentine court. The great composer Claudio Monteverdi was inspired by the accomplishments of the Camerata, and he wrote the first masterpiece of opera, the Orfeo, for a private aristocratic audience in Mantua.
My good friend, Claudio Monteverdi, was the victim of another cultural war that makes my blood boil. In 1600, the conservative musical theorist Giovanni Maria Artusi published a vicious diatribe against Monteverdi. He accused him of ignoring and even of violating the traditional rules of harmony. Artusi preferred the more conservative style of Costanza Porta, who was master of music at St. Anthony's Basilica near the Jesuit College. You can actually see the domes of the basilica from here.
Thank you.
Costanzo Porto wrote the motet we just heard. Artusi would have approved. The music is pleasant enough, but it certainly isn't Monteverdi.
Let me tell you about the most famous cultural war between Artusi and Monteverdi. It took place in the books published in Venice.
Artusi fired the first shot. He knew well the rules of counterpoint and harmony that he learned in Venice from the theorist Zarlino, and he championed the high Renaissance style of sacred music. In 1600, Artusi published a treatise entitled On the Imperfections of Modern Music. This treatise is set up as a dialogue between Vario, a master composer who expresses Artusi's own opinions, and Luca, his disciple. Vario rails against modern composers who ignore and abuse the traditional rules. It is my belief that there is nothing but smoke in the heads of such composers, and that they are so enamored of themselves as to think it within their power to corrupt, spoil, and ruin the good old rules handed down in former times by so many theorists and the most excellent musicians, the very men from whom these moderns have learned to string together a few notes with little grace. Artusi specifically mentions Costanzo Porta as one who follows the traditional rules. In fact, Artusi even includes a passage from one of Porta's works as an example of a good counterpoint.
Artusi hated composers that broke the rules. Ignorantly, he objected to some specific passages in Monteverdi's madrigal Crude Amarilli.
When Monteverdi published Crude Amarilli in his fifth book of madrigals, he fired back at Artusi in his preface. He explained that Artusi preferred an earlier style that Monteverdi termed the first practice, whereas Crude Amarilli was composed in a newer, a second practice.
Stated simply, in Artusi's first practice, the rules of music were dominant over the poetry. But in Monteverdi's second practice, the poetry came first. The role of music was simply to illustrate the meaning of the words.
My good friend Monteverdi clearly won this battle in the cultural wars when he was appointed Master of Musicians here at the San Marco in Venice, the most prestigious musical position in the world.
My daughter, Barbara Strozzi, wrote the music you just heard.
I wrote the poetry.
She sang it just a week ago at a meeting of the Academy that I organized in her honor. We call our group the Accademia degli Unisoni, because we all think in unison, unisoni. Well, at least we all like to be entertained by Barbara Strozzi. The group meets here in our home. And to stimulate conversation, my Barbara, she sings cantatas written especially for the topics of our meetings.
The members are all notable figures in the cultural life of Venice. I have published a list of our members along with an account of our meetings. We meet to discuss issues related to music.
Sometimes the issues are controversial. The topic of a recent meeting was whether slander stimulates virtue or inhibits it. Our topics often concern love, such as what fortune a particular flower would bring to love, or whether love causes happiness or unhappiness. But some here in Venice are jealous of our academy, and they have slandered my daughter's reputation. They have produced pamphlets they call satires in the form of letters and dialogues. These satires, they contain vicious slurs against my daughter's reputation, such as remarks about her handing out flowers to our academicians. Listen, it is a fine thing to distribute the flowers, having already surrendered the fruit. Oh, mio Dio. Here's another. To claim and to be chaste are very different. All the same, I too consider her extremely chaste, since as a woman with a liberal upbringing, she could have passed the time with some lover. yet she nevertheless concentrates all of her time on a castrato. Perhaps her love of a castrato explains her never having become pregnant. This is ridiculous. Barbara Strozzi has 4 children, no?
Barbara Strozzi is my adopted daughter, although I am also her natural father. I have given her the finest education I can provide. She is schooled as a poet, and she has studied music with Francesco Cavalli, who was organist at San Marco. Because of her great talent, she has attracted the affection of some of the most important leaders in Venice, especially Count Giovanni Paolo Wittmann, who fathered 3 of her children. Count Wittmann was quite wealthy, and he was very generous to Barbara. He was my patron as well. We rented a house from Giovanni Paolo, and I dedicated the libretto of my most successful opera to him. He has arranged for my 2 granddaughters to enter the prestigious convent of San Sepolcro, and for my grandson, he will arrange a professional office in the Doge's palace. One of Count Wittmann's favorite pieces of music was Barbara Strozzi's aria, Begli Occhi Bel Seno.
Scherzo e riso in ciel m'introducete voi pur begli occhi siete, ma tanto il cor m'ardete ed è il mio fuoco eterno per le porte del cielo. Cool.
In Venice, we are more liberal than in most of Europe. This can be partly explained by the traditions of marriage and money. To preserve property and wealth, many noble families only allow one son to marry. And since the price of dowries for marriage has become extremely high, typically they allow only one daughter to marry as well. The large number of unmarried Venetian noblemen supports a proportionately large number of professional courtesans. Some courtesans become mistresses, especially to men wealthy enough to support legitimate and illegitimate families. Similarly, a large percentage of unmarried noble women enter the convents. Many of us who consider ourselves as libertine are members of the Accademia dei Incogniti. Giovanni Francesco Loredano organized the Incogniti as a group of influential Venetian gentlemen who meet to discuss some provocative philosophical ideas. In fact, I organized my Unisoni as a, come si dice, splinter group of the Incogniti.
Loredano was a follower of Cremonini when he was a student at Padova, and he models our meetings on the debates held by Cremonini and Galileo. Our emblem pictures the River Nile from its well-known delta to its unknown source. For members of the Incogniti, secrecy is both a pose and a game. Our members include the most important Venetian intellectuals as well as many prominent foreigners. Gentlemen from other cities choose to live in Venice because of our liberality. Our publishing industry, she prospers without censorship. As long as a publication does not criticize the Venetian government, it can be printed and sold. Our Incogniti are prodigious writers of novels, satiric essays, religious tracts, and even opera librettos. Loredan, for example, has published transcripts of debates that took place in our meetings.
One of his books, entitled Academic Novelties, includes discourses on whether blushing is a sign of virtue or vice, on whether morality applies to card games, and why physicians have such a long beard. But some of the more libertine inclinations of our Incogniti get out of hand.
Perhaps one of our most notorious authors is Ferrante Pallavicino, who served for a while as Loredan's secretary. One of his books, The Celestial Divorce, infuriated the Pope, Maffeo Barberini, a biting satirist and critic of the Barberini papacy. Pallavicino depicted Jesus Christ telling God the Father that he wanted to divorce his bride, the Roman Church.
Christ insisted that the Church had committed intolerable adulteries and lived in a cesspool of vice. To investigate, God sent St. Paul down to earth, presumably because he could not trust St. Peter. Paul returned so scandalized that he recommended that Christ's request for a divorce should be granted. This was not so good day for the Church. A few years after the publication, Pallavicino received a written invitation from a French acquaintance, allegedly inviting him to become a secretary to Cardinal Richelieu in France. Pallavicino took the bait, went to France, was arrested in Avignon on one of the famous bridges, tried for heresy, and beheaded by papal agents. Fini.
Monteverde and I have collaborated on two operas. The first, she was a fiasco. Monteverde had been asked by Signor Strigio of Mantova to write a court opera for the Duke. We sent Strigio the first act, and he demanded to see my entire libretto immediately. Though I was very busy, I prepared the entire libretto. But Monteverde smelled trouble. Too many times the Duke of Mantova had not paid him for his work. So Monteverde took another commission from the Duke of Parma. The music for her opera in Mantova, she was never written. Our second collaboration, she was more fruitful. In 1630, a Proserpina Rapita was produced for a private audience at the Palazzo Mocenigo, here in Venice.
Thank you.
Venice has a long tradition that associates our carnival with theaters, courtesans, and a scandal. The interiors of our theaters are fitted with private boxes for spectators, stacked in a horseshoe shape. The privacy of the boxes has inspired scandal. Some of the boxes are even reserved for courtesans. And during our carnival season, before Lent, our theaters are very full.
In 1637, a traveling company led by Ferrari and Manelli presented Andromeda, the very first public opera. And the following year, the same troupe returned with a new production. In 1639, Manelli's troupe produced my opera, Delia, or The Night Bride of the Sun. But opera really took off in 1640, when Monteverdi introduced his new opera, The Return of Ulysses, along with a revival of an early opera, Arianna, in another theater.
In that same year, some of the Incogniti began construction on our own new opera house, committed to producing heroic operas that celebrate the importance of our beloved city.
In 1641, we enjoyed our first big hit. La Finta Pazza, or The Fake Mad Woman, set a new standard for spectacle with elaborate stage machinery and costumes. I wrote the libretto, and my friend Francesco Socrati wrote the music. Our designer of sets and stage machinery was Giacomo Torelli, and the prima donna was Anna Renzi, a protege of Socrati.
Our audience includes nobles, wealthy merchants, and foreigners here on business or for pleasure. The wealthy patrons use the opera house to entertain the business clients or to pursue personal romance. The theater owners provide for dining, drinking, and the gambling in the boxes. They serve the food and wine, they keep the bank, as in a casino.
Audiences for commercial operas in Venice demand a very different style from those produced in Florence 40 years ago. Those early operas use mythological plots to educate and inspire an invited audience of well-educated aristocrats.
The more diverse audience here in Venice wants to be entertained. They want more realistic characters, some comic for fun, some heroic for excitement. Our plots often contain sex and violence. And for patriotic inspiration, our plots often celebrate the glory of our most serene republic. But most of us attend the operas to hear the magnificent singers. The divine Anna Renzi is our most popular opera star. She sang the tragic role of Ottavia in the first production of Monteverdi's Coronation of Poppea. To punish his wife Ottavia for plotting to murder his mistress Poppea, the Emperor Nero banishes Ottavia from Rome.
Anna Rinzi was the prima donna of my opera La Finta Pazza. I published an entire book dedicated to the magic of her singing and acting.
Signora Anna Rinzi is a miracle on stage. She's a master of the fine art of acting. She understands that action, which gives a soul, a spirit, and existence to things, must be governed by the movements of the body, by the gestures, by the face, by the voice, now raising it, now lowering it, becoming enraged, and immediately becoming calm again, at times speaking hurriedly, at others slowly moving the body, now in one, now in another direction, drawing the arms in, extending them out, laughing and crying, now with a little, now with a much agitation of the hands. Our Signora Anna, she's endowed with such lifelike qualities that her responses and her speeches seem not memorized. No, they are born in the very moment. In some, she transforms herself completely into the person she represents, and now seems full of comic gaiety, now rich in tragic majesty. She has a fluent tongue, smooth pronunciation, not affected, not rapid, a full sonorous voice, not harsh, not hoarse, nor one that offends you with excessive subtlety. Her voice, she rises from the temperament of the chest and throat. For a good voice, much warmth is needed to expand the passages and enough humidity to soften it and make it tender. Signora Rinzi was the prima donna in the first two operas of my trilogy celebrating Venice as the heir to the glories of Greece and Rome. The first opera, La Finta Pazza, contains a Greek story. The second, La Finta Savia, contains a Latin one. The former leads towards the destruction of Troy. The latter refers to the future founding of Rome. The third opera, Romulus and Remus, tales of the founding of Rome, whose valor our most serene Republic of Venice has remained the eternal heir. Monteverdi's last three operas, they also form a trilogy. The return of Ulysses is a Greek story from Homer, whereas the marriage of Aeneas is a Roman story. The return of Ulysses follows the fall of Troy, whereas the marriage of Aeneas tells of the founding of Rome. The coronation of Poppea, Monteverdi's final opera, tells of the fall of Rome, paving the way for the glorious founding of Venice. How else does one explain an opera in which the hero orders the suicide of Rome's greatest educator and moral authority, his wife orders the murder of his mistress, and the ambitious mistress ends up as a heroine, crowned Empress of Rome? Monteverdi never completed the final scene of Coronation of Poppea. My good friend Francesco Sacrati composed this final duet.
Oh, mia
Thank you.